Dear guests, welcome to Donetsk People's Republic representative office in Helsinki and our press studio. Our guest today is a Norwegian academic and a scholar, Bjørn Nistad from Oslo. Welcome, Bjørn.
Thank you.
Bjørn, recently I saw a Norwegian television series. It's titled Okkupert. Mm-hmm. About the Russian occupation of Norway. So what is your opinion about this TV series, and have you seen it? And
I haven't seen it because I do not have a television set. I think Norwegian state television is state propaganda, and I do not want to see it or pay for it. So I haven't seen the series, just short parts of it, but it was just stupid. And I think even ordinary Norwegians reacted, politicians reacted, and it was just embarrassing. So it was not good propaganda. Of course, it was anti-Russian propaganda, but it was just stupid. I think people were just laughing at it.
But why Norway made such a television series about how Russia is occupying whole Norway?
It's stupid, but I think we have the same situation in all of Europe. The elite, which I would say is a globalist elite, I think they fear that they are losing control, that the people no longer believe in their view of the world, that there should be a world with no borders, you should destroy nation states. Money should be the only thing that unites people. I think people start to rebel against this, and Brexit, election of Trump, Le Pen, what's happening in Germany today. Of course, it scares the elites, and now they need a foreign enemy. So Russia is a convenient enemy. So I think this anti-Russian hysteria, I think it's created because the globalist elites who unfortunately rule in Europe, they are scared, and they need an enemy.
Mm. So the globalist elite is scared of what? That they lose their power,
yes,
or they lose their narrative?
I think they very much fear Putin and Russia. Of course, Russia and Putin, it's not a military threat. It would be stupid, absurd to claim that Russia is a military threat. But I think to the Western elites, Putin and Russia, it's a real political threat, because you have a different kind of democracy in Russia than you have in the Western world. And I would say that what we have in the West is fake democracy, and what you have in Russia is true democracy. And I shall try to explain the difference. I think the Russian concept of democracy is that democracy means ruled by the people, ruled by the majority. And there is no doubt that Putin and the Russian elite, everything they do, it's supported by 70-80% of the Russian people. You have opinion polls that show that. But in Norway and other Western countries, we learned that democracy, it's not ruled by the majority. The democracy is that we should accept various minorities, which I would call pressure groups. And the result is that it's impossible for ordinary people in Western countries like Norway to realize or defend their interest by voting. So in my opinion, we could just abolish the elections in Norway, because they make no sense. Now we have a conservative government. 4 years ago we had a green socialist government, but to ordinary people, nothing has changed. And I think if ordinary people knew the truth about Putin, Russia, how Russia is ruled, of course they would demand the same kind of politicians and the same kind of democracy. And I think that's the reason why Putin is demonized, why Russia is demonized. And it started before the crisis in Ukraine. Then you had lots of noise about the alleged persecutions of homosexuals in Russia and so on. So for the last 15 years at least, you have had continuous anti-Russian campaigns in Norway and other Western countries. And I'm sure this is because the globalists fear that they are losing power. And and they are really desperate. For example, in Norway, soon people will be forced to watch or at least pay for the state television. As I said, I have no television set because I consider state television to be just state propaganda. And until now, I do not have to pay for state television because I have no television set. But the politicians have decided, or they will soon decide, that if you have an address, you will have to pay for state television, even if you do not have a television set. And in my opinion, this is dictatorship. And our elites, they say this openly. We want state television. We will want to force people to watch state television because we do not want a Norwegian Trump or Le Pen. And so they say that we shall have state television so that we can decide what ordinary people will think in Norway. Mm. And I think it's the same all over Europe. And you have this new Orwellian, new words, fake news, conspiracy theories and so on. So it's the same when I listen to your Danish guest. I felt it's just the same, the situation in Norway. I talk to people from Germany and they say it's the same. So I think all in Western Europe, people are living under dictatorship, totalitarian dictatorship, censorship. Mm. And I can just mention one example of how this works. In Norway, we have a small independent newspaper, Nytid. And it's a very small newspaper. I think there are a few thousand people buy this newspaper. And this newspaper dared to publish an article where it questioned the official Western or American view of the September 11th attacks. And yes, they questioned this official version. And then there was an uproar, and all newspapers, all journalists, politicians and so on attacked this small newspaper. And this small newspaper is distributed by another bigger newspaper, which also calls itself socialist, but it's more a mainstream newspaper. It's called Klassekampen. And this newspaper, when they were confronted by this massive attack, they panicked, and they just a few days ago declared that they would no longer distribute the small newspaper, and this presumably means the end of this small newspaper. And I think what will happen next is that the mainstream media, state television and so on, they will find some story, and then they will attack this bigger newspaper, Klassekampen, and try to use the same tactics, and presumably it may be closed as well. So we have real McCarthyism in Norway, and people are afraid. Journalists are afraid. They know if they write something wrong, they will never get a job. They may lose the jobs, and scholars are afraid as well. So it's a very bad situation. But what's good then, what gives a kind of optimism, is that people no longer trust official mass media. So I think more Norwegians use the internet to find the news than people read newspaper or watch state television.
But one important question, you talked about censorship.
Yes.
And totalitarian censorship,
yes.
In the European Union and in Europe in general. But my question would be that does the journalist profession exist anymore? If there is a censorship and control and attacks against newspapers if you publish one wrong story, and you said people are afraid, journalists are afraid, so the journalist profession doesn't exist anymore.
No, I would say that we have now an independent press, independent mass media, and journalists as a kind of people who try to find the truth, criticize the people with power and so on, they no longer exist in Norway, I would say. And I have a concrete example. When you had the elections in America, absolutely all Norwegian newspapers said that Hillary Clinton would win with a big majority. And they wrote all things about Trump, that he was crazy, dangerous, and so on. And I remember that I tried to write just one article where I tried to defend Trump and said that perhaps we will get a more peaceful world, a better world, if he's elected. And I tried to send it to all the mainstream newspapers, and they all refused to publish it. And I could understand that if they had some other articles about American politics trying to defend Trump. I'm a Russian scholar, not an American scholar, but nevertheless, I'm a doctor of history, and I think I know something about American politics, and it was a reasonably argued article, but they all refused to publish it, and finally it was published by an internet newspaper. And then Trump was elected, and of course the journalists, they were in shock. And I've heard people who watched state television that the journalists, they were really in shock. They were almost crying. And I think that this shows that you have no independent mass media. But of course, people get skeptical because, of course, all the experts, all the newspapers said that Hillary Clinton would win with a big majority. And Trump also was elected. Of course, people started doubting newspapers.
So that was kind of a crisis.
Yes, and Brexit was another crisis. And the Norwegian people voted that we should stay out of the European Union. But of course, all the elites tried to get us in. And all the journalists that support the elite, and they were in shock. I think journalists were shocked, almost crying. And even things that should be interesting from a journalistic point of view are not reported by Norwegian mass media.
So there is no journalism?
No, not at all. And I can give you a concrete example. I think it was 2 weeks ago when Saakashvili and Timoshenko, they forced their way into Ukraine and said that called people just to topple the present Ukrainian government. It was some kind of a coup d'etat. And it was a dramatic history, and it was filmed how they crossed the border, pushed the border guards aside and so on. And I think just from a journalistic point of view, this must be interesting. It's an attempted coup d'etat in a big European country. And I in my information center, I wrote about it, published some articles, and I tried to call the journalists, state television and so on, and try to make them write about it. And they all refused to do so. True, this was the day after our election, but still, they haven't mentioned this. So things that is happening in Ukraine, it's not whether you are pro-Russian or pro-Western governments. It's just things that are interesting from a journalistic point of view. They're not mentioned. So
how do the journalists work then, if there is no journalism actually? So what do they do, and how do they work then?
I don't know. I think it must be hard to be a journalist in Western countries, because I think they're not stupid, and I think some of them are ashamed. They know that they are lying, but they know if they write something that it's not correct or wrong, they will never get a proper job. So they try to say what they have to say, and I think they say that I just write what all the others write, so do not blame me. But it's, I think 10-20 years ago, presumably you had the independent mass media, journalism was a profession, but no, it doesn't exist anymore. And I think people who try to be independent journalists are the ones who publish online commentaries and so on. And I can give you another example of how journalism or the ethos of journalism or professionalism of the journalism, how this doesn't work in Norway. You know, now it's a few months ago, you had demonstrations in Russia, and of course all over mass media declared that Navalny is a hero, he's a person who threatens Putin and so on, which I think is absurd. But I remember after this demonstration, I called some journalists, mainstream journalists, newspaper and so on, and asked, why do you not tell your readers what kind of person this Navalny is? Do you not know that he's an extreme Russian nationalist, that he has published videos where he says that Russians should take guns and shoot Caucasians and compare them to cockroaches and so on. So this is extremism, maybe fascism. And I asked the journalist, do you not know what kind of person this Navalny is? And of course, our journalists, they're not stupid, or not all of them, and most of them knew these stories, and they could not explain to me why they could not tell the public what kind of a person Navalny is. And so we have no freedom of expression, and we have a kind of a culture of fear. People are fear to lose their jobs if they say something wrong, and it's not just journalists, it's scholars as well. And I think
and
this
public officials.
Yes, so of course. I think 10, 20 years ago, scholars were independent people because they had their pay and they could say what they wanted and yes. And publish what they wanted, but today scholars have to apply for grants to finance their projects, and this means that scholars are no longer independent. They are controlled by the government or scientific funds and so on, and it means that. If you criticize the government, of course you will maybe not get fired, but it is hard to fire people. Maybe it will be easier, but still it's hard to fire people. But to get grants, it's almost of course impossible if you criticize the government.
Mm-hmm.
So
you're talking about culture of fear or censorship in the Western countries, but if you look at the Norwegian media, for example, the Norwegian media is writing about Russia, that Russia is an aggressor, Russia is delivering propaganda, fake news. Why this hysteria about Russia? Why?
I think Russia is used as some kind of deflection to. I think what they're doing at home, they say that this is not happening in Norway, it's happening in Russia. And I think maybe they have some kind of bad conscience, I don't know. And I'm not saying that everything is perfect in Russia, but I think it for Norwegian journalists, Norwegian politicians and so on, it should be more important to improve our own society and try to create independent mass media in Norway. That should be more important than discussing how things should be in Russia.
But it seems to me that when I'm listening to you, that actually the Western mass media is one of the biggest problems of our days today.
Yeah, so of course. And I think it's much more dangerous to defend Putin in a country like Norway than it is to criticize him in Russia. Of course, when I say that, try to say that to Norwegian journalists, they just laugh at me. But I've published a biography on Putin, and I bought all kinds of Russian biographies, history books, and so on, and about Putin. And I have some Russian books that openly say that Putin is mad, he's a psychopath, he's dangerous, and so on. And so, of course, this proves that you have a certain big amount of freedom to say what you will in Russia. But it's in my view, you have much more freedom of expression in Russia than in Norway. But I think maybe this is related to the fact that Norway is a very small country. I think maybe there is more freedom of expression in bigger Western countries like Britain, America, than it is in Norway, because Norway is a very big, small country, and if you say something which is considered to be wrong, people will always remember it. And it means that if you're a journalist and so say something which is maybe you criticize the establishment or something like that, you know that you will never get a job. And I think in Britain, America, Germany, bigger countries, presumably you can get some kind of a job because there are bigger population. It means that you can have small newspapers that still exist, and it means that you may presumably can exist as an independent journalist in Germany or Britain and criticize the government, criticize NATO and so on. But in Norway, it's impossible. And I think one of the reasons why Russia, there is much more freedom of expression in Russia, presumably because it's a much bigger country.
Thank you very much for the interview, Bjørn, thank you for coming to our program. This was Donetsk People's Republic representative office in Helsinki, our press studio. My name is Johan Bäckman. Thank you for your company, and welcome again.